Good morning. We start with breaking news from the Corruption Commission into New South Wales former Premier Gladys Berejiklian. She's facing a grilling over her secret relationship with Daryl Maguire. We'll go straight to New South Wales State Politics reporter Liz Daniels, who's across all the developments. Liz, good morning to you. She is in the stand right now. What she had to say?
Davina, lawyers for ICAC have dived straight into incredibly heavy questioning of the former Premier Gladys Berejiklian. She's been in the stand for about an hour and a half, and already she's been asked to spill the beans on all the intimate details of her relationship with Daryl Maguire. Now, ICAC is specifically interested in questioning exactly the nature of this relationship in order to determine whether or not the then Premier and Treasurer Gladys Berejiklian should have declared that she was in this relationship in order to avoid any potential conflict of interest. Have a listen to exactly how she describes her long-term relationship with her then MP Daryl Maguire.
Did you have similar feelings, by which I mean feelings of love and the like, as to those that Mr. Maguire identified in his evidence?
I had those feelings, but I was never assured of a level of commitment, which in my mind would have required me to introduce him to my parents or introduce him to my sisters or regard it as sufficiently significant to declare.
You and him at least discussed introducing Mr. Maguire to your parents as, in effect, a boyfriend or a close partner, is that right?
I'm sure we did discuss it.
So ICAC's lawyer, they're questioning the former Premier Gladys Berejiklian and trying to establish exactly how serious her relationship was with Daryl Maguire. They then moved on to questioning her about whether or not she gave him any preferential treatment during the years when she was his boss. Now, they were caught on several phone taps discussing funding for his electorate of Wagga Wagga in the Riverina. And it does appear Gladys Berejiklian can be heard telling Daryl Maguire that she will fix something for him, that he's complaining that he wants a hospital funded in Tumut, and she says, "I'll fix it." She then calls him back a very short time later, and this is what she says.
I've already got you the Wagga Hospital.
But they should have done it.
I know. I just spoke to Dom and I said, just put the 140 in the budget. He goes, no worries. He just does what I ask him to. All you do is shout at me sometimes or kiss. You already told
I'm
me.
Just,
I got it. Okay?
I'm an excitable person, that's all.
Yes, I know.
So there's Gladys Berejiklian talking to her then lover, Daryl Maguire, a secret lover. She's speaking about the Treasurer. She says she told Dominic Perrottet, the Treasurer, to put in money into the budget in 2018 for a hospital in Daryl Maguire's electorate. And with one phone call, Davina, he did it.
Well, Liz, in terms of what we saw this morning when Ms. Berejiklian walked in, it was a very different person.
That's right, Davina. She's had quite a combative questioning in the stand between her and ICAC's lawyer. He is really pressing her and they are going very much head-to-head. But Gladys Berejiklian that walked in here behind me this morning was a very relaxed person. She said hello to everybody and she was willing to take questions, including saying that she's been really buoyed by the public support she's received. Here she was this morning, just a couple of hours ago.
I'm looking forward to fulfilling my obligations and appearing before this inquiry. And obviously, I will strenuously stress again, as I have every day of my life in public office, that I've always put the interests of the public first and foremost. And my love and support for the people of this great state has always been the forefront of any decisions I've made in public life.
There you go, Davina. You can certainly see a change in tone between Gladys Berejiklian addressing the media this morning and Gladys Berejiklian answering questions in the hot seat at the corruption inquiry, investigating her conduct.
Okay, we are watching developments. If there's any breaking news, we'll cross back to you, Liz. Thank you. Well, destructive winds have lashed Melbourne and parts of Victoria, uprooting trees, ripping roofs from homes. Lana Murphy is live for us in Chelsea in Melbourne's southeast. Lana, good morning to you. There has been considerable damage to homes there.
Davina, the term wild weather really doesn't cut it today. The winds this morning have been ferocious right across our city and hundreds of homes have been destroyed. Many of them are right here in Chelsea where I'm standing. I'm currently surrounded by many homes with their roofs ripped off. This one behind me is currently being guarded by police. It is the home of a 93-year-old Holocaust survivor. Now, it was 7:30 this morning when she was asleep upstairs in her bedroom. It's her home of more than 40 years when a gust of wind came through at more than 100 kilometres per hour, ripping it from its roots. And much of that debris has then fallen on the 93-year-old. She's been able to get her mobile phone and call her adult son, who was living downstairs. And he and a neighbour have been able to climb upstairs and save her. Incredibly, she barely has a scratch.
Just about to have a shower and then a big noise and the whole roof came down. Went upstairs to get my mum and I don't know how she survived, but it's a miracle.
Davina, across Melbourne today, there have been more than 2,200 calls to the SES for assistance, and the bulk of that is for property damage and trees down. We have seen tens of thousands of trees collapsing right before people's eyes all across Victoria. The hardest hit suburbs and cities in our state include Frankston, the city of Whitehorse, Northcote and Ballarat in the northwest. There are still hundreds of thousands of homes in Victoria currently without power, and we are told that it could be days before that power is restored. Thankfully, the winds are dying down. It's moving across to Gippsland, and we should see some better weather as the afternoon progresses.
They'll need that as they start to clean up. Lana, thank you. Let's go to Isabella Staskowski, who's in Narre Warren in Melbourne's southeast.
Properties have been destroyed and more than 500,000 homes are without power this morning. Some have been told they won't regain power until at least Monday. The damage is widespread and extensive. Here in Narre Warren, crews have just arrived to clean up this tree that's fallen on a bus. Gusts of up to 110 kilometres per hour have been recorded. At least four train lines are down due to trees on tracks. Trams are impacted and residents are being urged to delay any travel plans. There's debris across roads, trees and power lines have fallen and traffic lights have stopped working. The roof of a Port Melbourne building has been blown off. Truck has toppled on the Craigieburn bypass. The power outages will affect businesses, retailers who today were to celebrate their Freedom Friday. The list of school closures is growing as well. Year 12 exams called off. It's expected Bayside, the Mornington Peninsula and Bass Coast will be worst hit. The SES has already received a record number of calls and it is experiencing major delays. As the storm continues, it will be a while yet until we find out just how long this cleanup is going to take.
Crazy weather in Queensland too. Dust storms have swirled around Thargomindra in the state southwest. The 91 kilometre an hour winds painting the town red. But neighbouring areas cop the severe thunderstorms. The Bureau of Meteorology has warned Queenslanders they haven't seen the end of it, for the showers and storms are forecast for today. An enormous cleanup is underway in South Australia this morning after fierce storms lashed the state. The SES responding to more than 1,300 call-outs in the past 24 hours, including a home in the Adelaide Hills where a large gum tree had fallen. Thousands of homes still without power after hail the size of golf balls, heavy rain and 100k winds hit parts of the state. It's predicted the damage bill could soar beyond $100 million, with vineyards and crops in some areas decimated. There's been a development in the strained relationship between Australia and France, with French President Emmanuel Macron calling Scott Morrison for the first time since their fallout over the scrap submarines deal. We'll go live to our political reporter, Fiona Whelan. Fee, good morning to you. What do we know about this phone call?
Well, Davina, we know that it went for around 30 minutes or so, and the timing was interesting because it happened just as Scott Morrison was about to board a plane for Rome, where he'll attend the G20 Leaders Summit, and Emmanuel Macron will also be there. So it is likely the two of them will be in the same place at some point. So perhaps this will pave the way for that encounter to be less awkward. The French president has certainly made no secret of the fact that he's angry with the government for scrapping a $90 billion submarine deal in September. December, the PM announced that Australia would instead opt for nuclear-powered submarines as part of a new alliance with the US and the UK. And even in that phone call overnight, the President indicated that he's still upset, telling the PM that Australia broke the relationship of trust. He's the Defence Minister.
Obviously, the French are upset. There's no question about that. So they've expressed that and we understand their frustration.
It's going to take a bit of time.
Okay.
And of course, this is an important first step and it's a welcome first step.
And it's no wonder that the trust was broken here. I mean, Scott Morrison told the French president about the news of ending the submarine deal by text.
Now, there are also differing versions of what was discussed. So the French side claims the president encouraged the PM to adopt more ambitious climate measures. According to the Australian side, that didn't happen. Now, Scott Morrison is still on his way to Rome. No doubt he'll face many questions about that call when he touches down tonight. Davina?
OK, Faith, thank you.